Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I formally declare open the 13th of August 2020 Ordinary Meeting of Council, and so doing, I welcome you all here tonight to this live stream meeting. I acknowledge the Whadjuk people of the Noongar Nation, who are the traditional custodians of the land in which we're gathered, and pay respect to the elders past, present and emerging, and extend that respect to Aboriginal and or Torres Strait Islander people that may be with us tonight or who are viewing the live streaming itself. Given the COVID-19 pandemic is still with us, there continues to be a need for social distancing and the following of hygiene requirements, i.e. hand washing, etc. Accordingly, the seating in the council chamber and the public gallery has been set out to ensure social distancing requirements are met. I ask that you follow the social distancing requirements during the meeting and when leaving the meeting itself. Also, please note that in regard to tonight's meeting, this council meeting will be electronically recorded and live streamed on the city's website, except where council resolves to go behind closed doors. All recordings are retained in accordance with the General Disposal Authority for Local Government Records produced by the State Records Office. A copy of the recorded proceedings and a transcript of the whole council meeting will be available on the website within 2 business days of the council meeting. This will be easy to find from the front page of the city's website. Images of the public gallery are not included in the webcast. However, the voices of people will be captured and streamed. So I therefore remind everyone present to be mindful of their conduct as this will be recorded. This is a council initiative aimed at increasing our transparency and openness, as well as making council meetings more accessible to our communities and those beyond. Thank you. I'll now proceed to the agenda proper, moving through to agenda item 3, the disclaimer, which I will now read. Members of the public who attend council meetings should not act immediately on anything they hear at the meeting without first seeking clarification of council's position. Persons are advised to wait for written advice from the council prior to taking any action on any matter that they may have before council. Agenda item 4, which is the acknowledgement or receipt of written declarations of financial interest and conflict of interest. I have one for Mr. Daniel Arndt, the Acting Chief Executive Officer, that relates to agenda item 18.1, which is a financial interest. Apologies, agenda item 5, apologies and leave of absence. We have apologies for Mr. Don Green, the Director of Governance and Community Services. Agenda item 6, written request for leave of absence, is not applicable. Agenda item 7, response to previous public questions taken on notice, that is nil. Now we move through to agenda item 8, which is public question time, and just advise that we have received requests in writing for 2 non-agenda items, and those people will be asked to come forward shortly. I'll just remind anyone coming forward who has a public question or questions that public question time is not for making statements. Is to provide you with the opportunity to ask a question or questions and receive, if appropriate or possible, a reply tonight from the city's administration. So, having said that, I'll just ask, firstly, if Richard McPherson is here, please. Not here. Okay, we'll provide a response to that particular series of questions from Mr. McPherson. The second one, which is again a non-agenda item, Judy Fogarty. Is Judy here, please? Thank you. Please come forward. And if you could just state your name for the record and then ask your question or questions. Thank you.
Good evening, councillors. Thank you for your time. I have three questions. The first one is, what has the city done to protect... Oh, sorry, wrong one. That wasn't my first question. What recent research has the city done in relation to the endangered and threatened flora and fauna communities of Manning Park Ridge?
Thank you, and I'll ask Mr Sullivan to respond to that. Mr Sullivan, thank you.
The city undertakes regular flora and fauna surveys in Manning Park to guide management practices to support endangered flora and fauna populations that are identified. This occurs every 4 years. The last surveys were undertaken in 2017.
Thank you. Mr Sullivan, your next question, please.
May I comment on that, or I have to move on?
No, please move on. Thank you.
Why are there no signs prohibiting the riding or otherwise illegal use of unsanctified trails constantly damaging the environment, the vegetation by the mountain bike riders? A simple sign at the beginning and end of each trail saying, trail closed to all users, damage to vegetation, top and bottom. Why cannot that be done?
Thank you, Mr Sullivan.
Through the chair, the Billiar Regional Park Management Plan indicates that cycling is of use in the upland region of Manning Park. The use of bicycles is not a prohibited use. The removal of vegetation and the killing of wildlife is illegal. Offenders will be prosecuted if suitable evidence is provided to enable offenders to be identified. The Manning Park Mountain Bike Concept Plan was recently out for public comment. Feedback indicated that the trails that exist are used by walkers, orienteering groups, trail runners and mountain bikers. Closing down the existing trails will disadvantage all users. The city would prefer to formalise and rationalise the trails to enable some of the unsanctioned and poorly designed trails to be shut down permanently. The city will form a working group made up of representatives of trail users and local residents to gain consensus on the establishment of dedicated mountain bike trails.
Thank you, Mr Sullivan. And your next question, please.
Could I just ask, what happens to the damage to the vegetation in between? This could be 6 months or a year off. And the trails are still, all users, walkers included,
yes,
not just mountain bike riders. These trails just keep honeycombing all through. So what happens in the meantime? Because this, no signs have been up for years and the trails are getting more and more wider and wider and more of them.
Yes, I think you can see Mr Sullivan following the meeting if you wish to get answers or send an email to Mr Sullivan if your question's not fully addressed to your satisfaction. So please continue now to your next question. Thank you.
Along the same lines, what has the city done to protect walkers in Manning Park when riders cross over sanctified trails, like a road base established by the City of Coburn, at speed from their own made trails? It's not possible to get their names in order to contact CoSafe. It's going too fast. You just have to leap out their way.
Thank you. Mr Sullivan?
Some trails have been shut down due to them being considered unsafe, and illegal structures have also been removed to enable safer pedestrian movement on the trails. Ranger patrols are also undertaken advising cyclists to stick to designated trails and be aware of others using the trails.
Thank you, Mr Sullivan. Thank you for those questions. And as I said earlier, if you've got other questions, you can please speak to Mr Sullivan following the meeting or send him an email tomorrow or telephone him. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the written questions that have been submitted. Has anyone got a question on tonight's agenda at all they wish to ask in a public gallery or a non-agenda item? If not, thank you. That concludes public question time. I'll just wait for Mr Downing to... Waiting for the furniture to be relocated. Ladies and gentlemen, at this point in the meeting, I'll call on Councillor Smith to make a statement. Councillor Smith, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. A complaint was made to the Local Government Standards Panel in which it was alleged that I contravened the Local Government Rules of Conduct Regulations 2007 WA when I did not remove material from a Facebook page relating to a petition regarding Bartram Road footbridge that incorrectly referred to the involvement of the Lions Club Australia. The panel found that I breached Regulation 7.1B of the said regulations as my conduct in refusing a reasonable request to remove the material was improper and deserving of a penalty. I accept that I should have removed the relevant material from Facebook upon request. I now apologise to the Lions Club of Australia, my fellow councillors and the public.
Thank you, Councillor Smith, for that statement. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll move to the next agenda item, which is the confirmation of the minutes. Firstly, 9.1, the minutes of the Ordinary Council meeting held on the 9th of July 2020. Can I have someone move for the adoption of those particular records? Thank you, Councillor Allen. Seconded, Councillor Stone. Thank you. Is there any discussion or debate? If not, I'll put that all those in favour. Thank you. Declare that carried. Moving through to agenda item 9.2, which is the minutes of the special council meeting held on the 23rd of July 2020. I have someone move for the adoption of those as a correct record. Councillor Allen, thank you. Seconded. Councillor Cork, thank you. Is any discussion or debate? If not, I'll put that all those in favour. Against, declare it carried. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 10, which is deputations, of which there are nil tonight. Agenda item 11, the business left over from the previous meeting, if adjourned, which is nil. Agenda item 12, declaration of members who have not given due consideration to matters contained in the business paper presented before the meeting. Are there any such declarations? No, thank you. Moving through to agenda item 13, at this point in time, I'll be asking Mr. Arndt to read out the items that are listed to be carried in block, but of course following that there'll be an opportunity for elected members to withdraw one or more of those particular agenda items. Mr. Arndt, thank you.
Through the Chair, the items that are proposed to be carried on block are items 13.4, 14.1, 14.2, 14.3, 14.4, 15.1, 15.2, 16.1, 17.1, 21.1, 21.2, 22.1, 22.2, 22.3. Noting that there are three items for discussion, which are items 13.1, 13.2, and items 13.3 requires an absolute majority. Item 17.2 has also been withdrawn because there's an alternative recommendation. Item 18.1 has been withdrawn because there's a declaration of financial interest. And there are three matters for investigation that have been included. They are items 22.4, 22.5 and 22.6.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt. Are there any members who wish to withdraw one or more of the agenda items? Councillor Corp, thank you. 21.2. Mr. Downing? Thank you. Councillor Smith? 22.2. Are there any other members who wish to withdraw an item? No. So then we've got those items that are listed there to be carried in block. Can we have someone move that way, please? Councillor Siparovic, seconded. Councillor Tablanche. I'll now put that all those in favour. Against. Declare it carried. Thank you. So we're going to agenda item 13.1. Councillor Weidenbach, thank you.
Yes, 13.1. Do we have to move the first part?
Yes.
Do I need to provide a reason? Oh, the council adopts the recommendation subject to the exclusion of 9.1 Coburn Community Men Shed Funding Commission and Key Performance Indicators, which will be considered separately.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. Seconded Councillor Allen, thank you. And now, any discussion or debate on this item? If Councillor Smith, thank you.
I've got some questions in terms of the motion that's now on the table in relation to the men's shed.
No, this is the adoption of the minutes with the exclusion of that particular item.
Thanks.
So no further questions or anyone wishing to speak against. I'll now put that then. That's the adoption of the agenda item with the exclusion of item 9.1. So all those in favour? Against, declare it carried. Thank you. Councillor Weidenbach, the next alternative. Thank you.
Yes, I have an alternative. The council adopt the committee recommendation subject to the inclusion of the additional KPI number 10 as below. 10, community engagement. The shed is to monitor community engagement through the number of people attending shed events, the number of items built provided to the Coburn community and any other relevant community engagements by the shed. Proposed KPI, increase community engagement at a minimum rate of not less than 5% per year.
Thank you. To you, Councillor Weidenbach. Do we have a seconder? Councillor Stone and Councillor Weidenbach, your reason. Thank you.
Yeah, currently the men's shed do not gather data on the number of engagements it has with the local community. I propose that the men's shed incorporate an additional KPI to measure their engagement with the community and aim to increase this engagement in the same fashion as they aim to increase the membership numbers in KPI number 2. The additional KPI is to be included in the KPI look forward list 2020 and beyond.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. Do we have anyone who wishes to speak against the alternative? Question, Councillor Smith, thank you.
Yes, so just through the chair to Councillor Weidenbach. Did you engage with the men's shed and seek their support for the addition of this extra guy?
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Councillor Weidenbach, thank you.
No, I have not.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. Any further questions, yes. Councillor Smith?
Yeah, so a little bit curious as to why you didn't do that, given that they were applying and they now have to achieve that KPI. So if they don't achieve that KPI, what do you expect the outcome to be?
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Councillor Weidenbach, thank you.
I'm only asking for this KPI to be included and to be measured, as they currently don't do any measurement of how many people go to events, how many people... Can I finish?
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. Please continue.
They don't currently measure what they do, and they're an intangible asset to the community. They do a lot of great things. I want them to measure the extra things they do so we can document how great they are and what they provide for the community. I'm not using this as an avenue to cut funding or to detriment them in any way. I just want an extra check that we can say, look how great we're doing.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. Further question, Councillor Smith?
I'll repeat the question. If they don't achieve that KPI, what do you expect the outcome to be, given that you're now asking them to achieve that KPI and they don't even know about it?
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Councillor Weidenbach, thank you.
I imagine the KPI will be considered at the next time it comes to council for funding, and if they either have or haven't achieved it, that will be considered with the other 9 KPIs. I imagine they don't hit every single KPI and they still receive funding.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach. Councillor Smith, thank you.
I guess I've probably got a point of order around that, because I don't know where that just came from there, where you just said that I assume they don't achieve their KPIs. So I've got a point of order around that.
Councillor Smith, your point of order is...
The point of order is for you to say that you assume the men's shed don't achieve all of their KPIs. I have a point of order around that particular comment that was just made.
Thank you, Councillor Smith. I'll give given consideration to that, and I accept your point of order. So, Councillor Weidenbach, if you want to expand on that or not in regard to the outcomes if of not achieved or your intentions, thank you. Thank you. Any other questions? Anyone wishing to speak against the alternative? Councillor Weidenbach, the opportunity to close if you wish. No, I'm sorry.
I want to speak against it.
Okay, well, I'll just ask that. No one...
I put my hand up. Thank you. Didn't see me.
Yeah. Thank you, Councillor Smith.
Thank you. Yeah, I'll speak against the motion. It's lovely to hear that you say you want them to expand and share more about the great work that they do. I've worked in the not-for-profit sector for about 30 years, and certainly when it comes to putting KPIs into place, it's something that you need to have the organisation on board if you're asking them to achieve that KPI. I have no issue with the KPI, however, I think that would have been out of respect that you would consult with the Menshep before you impose the additional reporting requirement on them, and for that reason I'll speak against the motion.
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Anyone wishing to speak for the alternative? Councillor Zaparovic, thank you.
I think that it's prudent to add that KPI. I mean, if you're going to be handing $30,000 over to an organisation so that they can boost the amount of people they have attending, it would be nice if you could at least measure to see whether they've had an increase in the amount of people attending. If we're spending $30,000 and not getting anything for it, that to me seems like a pretty prime waste of money.
Thank you, Councillor Zaparovic. Anyone wishing to speak against the alternative? If not, Councillor Weidenbach, the opportunity to close. Thank you.
Yeah, I think it's worth remembering that MenShed, they're an intangible asset to the Coburn community. They do a lot of great, but it's not documented what they do and what services they provide other than a hearsay. I think this opportunity in this KPI really presents the opportunity to move forward and show what they do and how much they present. And it's one of 10. It's not going to prevent any stumbling blocks for them. And especially over the next 12 months, it's just measure what it is. The KPI then goes into effect after 12 months.
Thank you, Councillor Weidenbach, for the alternative and the closing statement. I'll now put the alternative. All those in favour? Against? Declare it carried. Thank you. That was 8-2 for the benefit of the minute clerk. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 13.2, which is the Minister of the Audit and Strategic Finance Committee meeting. Do we have a mover for that? Oh, actually, I've got an alternative. Thank you, Councillor Allen. I've got an alternative here that Council received the Minister of the Audit and Strategic Finance Committee meeting held on Thursday, the 16th of July 2020, and adopted recommendations contained therein, subject to a minor amendment in the declaration of the meeting section to record Councillor Allen as the presiding member and not myself, Mayor Howlett. Do we have a seconder for that? Deputy Mayor Kirkwood, thank you. And the reason briefly for that is Councillor Allen was a presiding member, and therefore this statement included in the declaration of the meeting needs to be amended to reflect that circumstance. Do you have anyone wishing to speak against or ask a question? If not, I'll put that, all those in favour, against, declare it carried. Thank you. Agenda item 13.3, membership of the Audit and Strategic Finance Committee. We've got to be carried by an absolute majority. Do we have a mover? Councillor Allen, thank you. Seconded. Councillor Zaparovic. Is there any discussion or debate on this matter at all? If not, all those in favour? Against, declare it carried. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 17.2. Can we have someone move that way, please, for the alternative? Councillor Smith, thank you. Seconded. Councillor Cork, is there any discussion or perhaps Councillor Smith, you just wanted to read that reason that's listed there. Thank you.
Sure, yeah. The reason is that the City has received a statutory declaration from Deborah McLaughlin. Ms McLaughlin has since advised that she will be rehoming the dogs and will confirm their new addresses within the City upon their relocation.
Thank you, Councillor Smith. We've got a mover and a seconder. Councillor Stone, you've got a question, have you?
Yes, I do, through the Chair. I just was wondering if there was a time frame for the rehoming of those dogs. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Stone. Mr. Arndt, thank you.
Through the chair, that will be negotiated with Council's Ranger Services, but certainly they will be looking at rehoming the dogs as quickly as possible.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt, for that response. Any further questions? Anyone wish to speak against? If not, I'll put that. All those in favour? The alternative? Against? Declare it carried. Thank you. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 18.1, where we have a declaration of financial interest from Mr. Daniel Arndt, the Acting Chief of Executive Officer. And it's addressed to myself. I wish to declare a financial interest in item 18.1 of the 13th of August 2020 Ordinary Council Meeting, Minutes of the Chief Executive Officer Performance and Senior Staff Key Projects Appraisal Committee Meeting of the 28th of July 2020 pursuant to Section 5.60A of the Local Government Act 1995. The nature of my interest is that I am currently the Acting Chief Executive Officer, signed Mr. Daniel Arndt. Thank you. Noting that Mr. Arndt's leaving the council chamber. Can we have someone move for the adoption of the Councillor Allen? Thank you. Seconded, Councillor Siparovic. Is there any discussion on this particular agenda item? If not, I'll put that. All those in favour? Against? Declare it carried. Thank you. And could we just ask Mr. Arndt to return to the meeting? Thank you. Just advising Mr. Arndt, during your absence, the recommendation was adopted unanimously by the council. Thank you. Now, agenda item 21.2, a leave of absence, Councillor Chamonix to Blanche, been withdrawn. Councillor Cork, thank you.
Thank you. Through the chair, question.
Sorry, Councillor Cork, are you moving this?
I have a question.
Do you need to move it first, and if you wish?
Oh, sorry, I move it.
Thank you, Councillor Cork. Thank you. And seconded, Councillor Allen. Thank you. Councillor Cork, you have a question. Thank you.
Yes, I have a question for Councillor to Blanche, please, through the chair. I have the understanding that you actually applied to attend the October meeting by electronic means. Is that correct? Is that still your preference?
Thank you, Councillor Cork. Councillor to Blanche, thank you.
Okay, so I'd like to foreshadow an alternate motion that Councillor to Blanche be allowed to attend the October meeting remotely by electronic means, but be granted a leave of absence for the other two meetings when she will not be in Western Australia. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Cork. So you're foreshadowing that. A question from Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. Thank you.
Oh, sorry. I just have a question on that point through the chair. I had an understanding, I suppose, to a governance that you had to explain where you were going to be in order to have that permission granted. Is that correct? So do we have that?
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. Thank you, Councillor Allen. Ms. Bowman, thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Yes, that's correct. Under the requirements, a suitable place needs to be nominated within a town site within Western Australia, 150 kilometres within Western Australia from the city of Coburn. So a suitable place needs to be specifically identified, and at the point in time when Mr. Green went on leave, we didn't have a particular place that Councillor to Blanche had nominated. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bowman. Any further questions? Councillor Allen, thank you.
Really, does it matter if it's leave of absence or phone in? Well, unless, of course, you can now advise that the location, well, when I say the location, not just a caravan park or whatever it is, or it's a hotel, etc.
Thank you, Councillor Allen. Councillor Tabonch, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Allen, for the question. I have nominated four places that I'm intending to be because I'm not sure whether I will be in which one of those four places because we will be travelling and I'm not sure how long it will take us to get there. So I was wishing for Council to approve four places and depending on which one of those four we are able to reach by the time that it's the Council meeting, I was hoping that the Council would be able to approve those four. And those four are either Broome or Halls Creek or Fitzroy Crossing or Kununurra because those are, I'll be in one of those four places. And so my question to Council would be, would they consider approving all four? And depending on how we progress with our travels, I'll be in one of those four places. And to answer the question further to what Councillor Allen has said, I guess ultimately no, it doesn't make a difference because whether I'm in remote attendance or whether I have three leaves of absences, it doesn't matter, except for the fact that I'm really interested and I do enjoy my role as a councillor and I would like to be involved as much as possible. So while I'm still within the borders of Western Australia and I'm able to be and I'm meeting the requirements according to the Act, I wish to be able to attend the meeting.
Thank you, Councillor Tablanche. Ms Bowman, did you want to comment on that? Thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Just to reiterate, the requirements in the Act do state that it needs to be a suitable place, not multiple locations that are approved by Council. So the officer's recommendation would be, if that had come forward, to not support that recommendation because it needs to be one suitable place, not multiple ones. Thank you, Your Worship.
Thank you, Ms Bowman, for that. Question, firstly, Councillor Cork. If you have a question, do you? Yes, thank you. Councillor Cork.
Does the place have to be determined at this time? Would it be possible to grant the leave of absence for the second two meetings? And once Councillor de Planche has determined where she will be, closer to the actual date of the October meeting, then grant permission for that place?
Thank you, Councillor Cork. Ms Bowman, thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. I suppose this item's come to the Council meeting tonight and because Councillor de Blanche can't identify what that particular place will be, it would need to go to another Council meeting for Council to resolve that suitable place. But because the leave of absence has already been granted possibly tonight by Council, I would need to take that question on notice to see if it's already been approved as a leave of absence, whether it could then be changed to approve Councillor de Planche attending the meeting at the subsequent Council meeting in September.
Thank you, Ms Bowman. Thank you, Councillor Smith. Thank you.
Yeah, I would like to be as flexible as we possibly can. I mean, is there another way around it? Instead of a leave of absence, can you just be putting in a motion to be phoning in remotely?
Thank you, Councillor Smith.
But the and this, just the follow-up question to that, I think it's a bit vague to say I'm going to be in Kununurra, Broome or Darwin or wherever. I think it's more around that. Is that it's because you're not identifying 21B Smith Street?
Thank you, Councillor Smith. And Ms Bowman.
Thank you, Worship. Yes, that's correct. Because it is a Council meeting, a formal process, a suitable place would normally be a particular location where the person participating in the Council meeting process could identify that they're in a private space that was suitable for conducting that meeting process. Thank you, Worship.
Thank you, Ms Bowman. Not this point. Yes, Councillor Tabonche, you've got a question, have you?
Thank you, Your Worship. I guess the question would be to Ms Bowman then. I indicated that we will be travelling in a motorhome and that I will ensure, as I have always done, that I will show up to the meeting in a proper and a professional manner and that I will ensure that I bring myself to the table, so to say, in the ways that I've always done. So I don't think that there should be any doubt by any councillor around this table that I will be in a proper place. I suggested that it be our motorhome just because it makes sense, and we will most probably be in a caravan park because that's where you go with a motorhome, and it will be within one of those four town sites. If it's not possible for council to approve four town sites, which I, according to my reading from the Act, I don't see a problem with it. It says it needs to be a suitable place, and if council approve four places, in the end, I will still be in one suitable place that I will be attending it from. I won't be attending it from all four of those places. So it's just to have the flexibility. But if that's an issue, I would have probably thought I could say Broome or one. I could choose one of those places. But it's, I personally just feel that it's not really very flexible because we are travelling and we don't know how fast we will be able to be moving around. So my wishes would be for council, if possible, if that's what Ms. Bauman would suggest, to choose one of those locations, let's say Fitzroy Crossing, we'll make it in the middle of the four, and in a motorhome in a caravan park. So that would be my more specific gesture. And the question, I guess, is would that be acceptable?
Thank you, Councillor de Blanche. Ms. Bowman. And then Mr. Hart may want to respond as well, and I've got a question from Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. So firstly, Ms. Bowman, thank you.
Thank you, Worship. Yes, if it was actually a specific location that Councillor de Blanche nominated rather than multiple town sites, which was the original discussion that we had held, that would be within the requirements of the Act. As long as she could then identify that she was going to be able to conduct the meeting process in a private location within the motorhome, and it was that specific town site that she was nominating, then they were the conditions we were talking about previously. Thank you, Your Worship.
Thank you, Ms. Bowman. And Ms. Dart, did you want to comment? Thank you.
Yeah, just point of clarification. I did discuss this with the Director of Governance before he went on leave. It was very clear that he identified that it had to be a singular place, not multiple places. And the other concern was ensuring that it was a place that was actually private and secure, so that if council chose to go behind closed doors or discuss confidential items, it couldn't actually be overheard by third parties. So that was the issues that we actually raised and identified that they had to actually be meeting those criteria.
Thank you, Ms. Dart.
Point of order.
Yep. Point of order?
Yes.
Yes,
if I may put a point of order to the CEO.
Yes, point of order is?
The point of order is that nowhere in the Act it actually states that it needs to be, what were the things you said, a secure private. It's not stated in the Act at all. It says a suitable place according to council.
Thank you, Councillor de Blanche, for that point of order. However, I understand those matters have been clearly explained to you on more than one occasion by the Director of Governance and Community Services, so I won't accept that point of order. Thank you. Deputy Mayor Kirkwood, you had a question. Thank you.
A question through the chair to Mr. Daniel Ont. Mr. Ont, can you just let me know, as Councillor Smith is also away, possibly for that month as well, including for a few more months to come, as she has also asked to conduct her meetings from another location, and Councillor Blanche has put in an application today, what support is going to be put in place for the East Ward residents on site? As obviously, I might be the only elected member who's here. So will there be notes on websites or out of offices?
Just one moment. Your point of order, Councillor Smith. Thank you. Councillor Allen, thank you. Councillor Smith,
my point of order is at this point in time, there is nothing to say that I won't be here in those additional few months.
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Your point of order is accepted. Deputy Mayor Kirkwood, did you have any further
My apologies, Councillor Smith. I meant to say that you were possibly having the meetings at another location. That's what I meant to say. So my apologies. Yeah, so to my point to Daniel and Mr. Arndt, will there be any further support for the East Ward residents who require meetings here with elected members?
Thank you, Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. Mr. Arndt, thank you.
Through the Chair, residents are able to actually contact and speak to any elected members. It doesn't need to actually be specific elected members for that particular ward. You would probably have to have the discussion with Councillors Blanche and Councillor Smith as to how they wish to be advised of any discussions that residents were wanting to actually have, and whether or not they were able to actually provide alternative means of participating in those discussions. But as I pointed out, any decisions are actually made on behalf of the entire council, and therefore any elected member can obviously be involved in those discussions.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt. Councillor Stepanovic, you had a question. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, is there any reason why this matter can't be deferred to a special council meeting to be held on October the 8th at 6:50? Like, why can't we just have a special council meeting 10 minutes before the meeting where we approve where she'll be attending from? Because she'll know exactly where she'll be 10 minutes prior to the meeting.
Thank you, Councillor Stepanovic. Mr. Arndt, do you want to respond to that? Thank you.
Any special council meeting would actually have to be approved by the presiding member. The issue being that if we were going to call that, one of the key issues there is that Councillor Blanche would actually have to provide sufficient detail to be able to say that, yes, she meets the actual requirements. Now, whether we have a special meeting before there, as I said, would actually have to be through the normal council procedures, which is usually the council, the mayor being notified or mayor advising that a special council meeting is called, and usually we try and do that with 24 hours notice prior to any meeting actually being held.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt. Thank you. Yep. Councillor Stepanovic, you got a further question?
This is more than 24 hours notice. I'm saying, can we call a special council meeting with 2 months notice to have a special council meeting 10 minutes before the meeting? All of the information that you're saying would needed to be provided to establish that it was a suitable place could all be provided in a meeting, in a special council meeting that was held 10 minutes before the ordinary council meeting. So is there any reason why we cannot do that?
Thank you, Councillor Stepanovic. Mr. Arndt, thank you.
Through the Chair, I thought I actually answered that question and said that the special council meeting or any calling of a special council meeting needs to actually be authorised by the Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Arndt.
So just to clarify, we can do that just as long as Mr. Mayor says so.
Thank you, Councillor Stepanovic. Mr. Arndt, thank you.
I think I just clarified that. I indicated that any special council meeting in accordance with the provisions of the regulatory provisions has to be authorised by the Mayor. Now, that would be a case of there'd have to be sufficient reason for a meeting to be held and the Mayor to then actually agree to having that meeting being held.
Thank you, Ms. Arndt. Just clarify that, because it can also be called a special council meeting by four or more elected members as well. So that's another provision within the Act. Thank you. Councillor Cork, I think you had your hand up next. Thank you. Question?
I'd like to push up an alternative recommendation at this point.
We've currently got one that's on the floor at the moment. That's on the being moved and seconded. So you earlier foreshadowed.
Yes. So I was wondering.
So we haven't considered this particular matter.
Okay, I'm confused.
At this point in time, Councillor Smith. Question?
Yeah, I've got a question through the Chair to Ms. Bowman. It's my understanding that if Councillor de Blanche doesn't have an address at this point in time, that we can actually move the motion on the night. So she can phone in. We can move. Mr. Green advised me of this just recently when I
obviously was moving around, and mentioned that we could actually, on the night, a motion could be put on the table at the beginning of the council meeting, that I could advise where my address was, and it would be up to elected members that evening to decide whether or not I could phone in. So I'm just, my question being then, for the next 3 months, Councillor de Blanche, there could be a motion on the table that's moved, and if she can phone in, she has an address that's approved that she can phone in.
Thank you, Councillor Smith and Ms Bowman. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Yes, I do believe Mr Green has said that previously regarding your request, so that is an option that would be available. So obviously Councillor de Blanche couldn't participate in the meeting until there was a council decision that permitted her to do that. But yes, you're correct. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Bowman. So any further questions? Anyone? We've got a mover and second for the leave of absence. Yes, Councillor Allen, thank you. Question?
Yeah, look, I know that another councillor has foreshadowed an alternative. I don't think this is urgent tonight. It can still go to the next meeting, because I don't think it's... is it from September, is it? October, isn't it?
Thank you,
Which means we could bring it back to the September, but I'd like to get more clarity around that. So I'd be suggesting that we defer until we get far more clarity around this, and to ensure that we're not going against the Act. And
thank you, Councillor Allen. Councillor de Blanche, you wanted to respond to that? Thank you.
I need to have clarification, because it influences our travelling plans. So if I'm not able to get either the remote attendance or the leave of absence request approved tonight, then it changes our dates of travel, which
Thank
obviously
you, Councillor
we need
DeBlanche.
To clarify now.
Thank you, Councillor de Blanche. So we've got a mover and second. Does anyone want to speak against? Councillor Allen, thank you. And anyone wish to speak against the alternative that's before us? Or not the alternative, but the recommendation? If not...
To clarify, is that's the officer's recommendation to deny it?
That's correct, Councillor Saparovic. So there's an opportunity for Councillor Cork to close, if you wish. Thank you.
Okay, I'm extremely confused. I wanted to put up an alternative recommendation to the officer's recommendation.
Cork, you've moved the recommendation that's in the report, papers before us. It's been seconded by Councillor Allen. So you have an opportunity to close now, if you wish.
But I foreshadowed.
That's all right, but this matter needs to be addressed in the first instance.
Closing by speaking against the motion. Right, thank you. I'd like to speak against this motion because I have an alternative recommendation that I wish to put up.
Thank you, Councillor Cork. Thank you. It's been closed now. Thank you. We've got the councillors, thank you. We've got the recommendation that's before us, been moved by Councillor Cork.
Seconded
by Councillor Allen. No, I'm sorry, there's no further debate. So I'll now put that all those in favour of the recommendation that's been provided in the report. Against? 5. Doesn't require an absolute majority according to the, so I declare it carried. Thank you. No, it was for the matter that was before us. That's what it was for. That's in the papers, the agenda papers that are presented before us. So it's already, the matter's now been decided. So I declare that that's been approved as per the papers that came before council. Thank you.
Excuse me, Mr.
No, thank you.
Can we just get clarification on exactly what was voted through? Because there seems to be confusion.
No, there's no confusion because it's in the papers that were provided to us.
Point of order. It was 6-4
against. No, there's no
point
of order. No point of order.
The vote was 6-4 against.
No, five all, thank you. We'll now move through to the next agenda item, which is 22.2, is it, I think?
Yes,
22.2. It's been removed for discussion. Do we have a mover for that item? Councillor Smith. Thank you. Seconded. Councillors, are we going to second for that item, 22.2, Councillor Weidenbach, and it was withdrawn by Councillor Smith. He had a question. Thank you.
Yeah, I've just got a question, and I'm sorry, I'm using my phone because I didn't bring my iPad with me. Towards the end of the motion, page 512, it says, further to the initiatives and proposed action for 2021, a few options which could be considered are. So my question is, officers are not recommending these as options. They're just saying that these are options that could be considered. Is that correct? So we've received a pretty, I guess it's a bit of a vague report that mentions that, yes, I agree, the staff have done quite a considerable amount of work. However, these are only options that could be considered. So it's not actually proposing options that will be considered, is that correct?
Thank you, Councillor Smith. I'm Mr. Arndt, thank you.
Through the chair, if you get goes on to actually talk about what is actually proposed, and that is that the ongoing solutions would be further lighting to be installed this financial year and investigations into suitable CCTV to actually be looked at.
Just another question in relation to the CCTV, because the CCTV has been extremely effective and it's only been removed for short bursts of time. Is there any reason why we can't continue with the CCTV footage in that area? I mean, that, and because you are aware of the amount of trauma that this antisocial behaviour is causing the surrounding residents. So is there any reason why the CCTV footage can't be installed permanently there?
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Mr. Sullivan, thank you.
Through the chair, the cameras that were previously there were not actually CCTV, they were cameras, and consequently they were producing literally hundreds, thousands of images, which was taking a huge amount of staff time to assess and then provide evidence to the WA police, which indeed has resulted in some prosecutions. So hence what we're looking at is lives in by actual CCTV cameras, providing the budget that I've indicated there can be found later in this financial year. So because it's not an actual approved council budget item, I've had to say that it could be considered, but I've got every confidence to think that an amount of approximately $30,000 can and will be found from budget reallocations as we move through the financial year. I've already requested additional patrols at random times to try and catch these people that are doing the antisocial behaviour. As we all know, the antisocial behaviour is less prevalent during the colder months where we are now. So the increase in patrols at random times will commence in the summertime. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sullivan. It's Councillor Smith, a question.
Just my last question then is, so that I don't feel the need to move an alternative recommendation or ask for further support in terms of mid-year or budget reviews, are you telling me that the staff are currently in favour, although they don't have the amount of money on budget at this time, they are in favour of the CCTV footage in the future?
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Mr. Arndt, thank you.
The answer is that's what's under investigation in terms of putting in place, identifying where the locations of CCTV would go, what type of equipment is needed to actually ensure that it connects live streamed to our base station, because then we can actually operate with the AI technology to actually ensure that it identifies when there are individuals in locations at times outside of what you would expect individuals to actually be there. And that's the issue that we're just working through at the moment. And that's why I said that it's under investigation, because we need to actually put in place and work out what the actual cost requirements are and what are the logistics that need to actually be done. And then we can obviously include that back to council in terms of asking for if there's funding that's needed to, or whether we can actually incorporate that within the current budgets.
Thank you, Mr. Hunt. Further question, Councillor
Smith? Sorry to be a pain, but further investigation, this has been going on for like 3 years. We all know what the issues are, and those residents are going through traumatic experiences relating to these, to what's going on in terms of that behaviour. This isn't something new. We actually don't need another report to come back. This is probably the second or third that's already come back. So I guess, can we foreshadow an alternative recommendation that says, that gives us a date that you are going to come back with some solid recommendations, rather than just say, maybe will be considered? What can I do to work with you to feel more reassured? Because Daniel, this is not something new that requires another report.
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Mr. Hunt, did you want to respond to that? Thank you.
Through the chair, I wasn't actually saying that there needed to be another report. What I'm saying is the officers are currently looking at what needs to be done to actually put in place CCTV cameras there in terms of the logistics as to not only the physical infrastructure, but what needs to actually be done in terms of the actual connections between this park. That means that we have the ability to actually live stream back to the control centre. All that's been done at the moment, and then they would be looking at in terms of, and what is the cost, and whether the cost can be actually incorporated within the current budget, which is very likely that it will be if it's, you know, a reasonable cost. If it is actually a higher cost, then all we will do is actually put that forward as part of the mid-year budget review to actually say we need to have additional funds to be able to undertake that.
Thank you, Mr. Hunt. Any further questions on this item? It had moved and seconded. If not, I'll put that all those in favour. Against, declare it carried. Thank you. Moving through to agenda item 22.4, which I'll read. Traffic calming options along South Lake Drive, South Lake. Councillor Weidenbach has requested a report on traffic calming options along South Lake Drive, South Lake. 22.5, future uses of unmade Metropolitan Region Scheme, MRS in brackets, road reserves in the northern area of the city and along the Coburn Coast development area. Councillor Cork has requested a report into future uses of unmade MRS road reserves in the northern area of the city and along the Coburn Coast development area. And 22.6, activities at the Manning Park, Azadi Leigh Homestead Museum precinct, including the wagon shed. Councillor Allen has requested a report into the activities at the Manning Park, Azadi Leigh Homestead or Museum precinct, including the wagon shed. So that'll be provided as with the other reports in due course through the city's administration. Moving through to the next agenda item, which is the resolution of compliance, agenda item 24. Do we have someone move that way? Councillor Smith, thank you. Seconded, Deputy Mayor Kirkwood. I'll now put that all those in favour. Against, declare it carried. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the closure of tonight's meeting. Thank you for your attendance and participation. And hopefully those people that are viewing the live streaming, they've had a chance to sit back and see how the council operates and the decisions that they make in regard to the matters that have come before us on the agenda paper. So having said that, I declare the meeting closed at 7:59 p.m. Thank you.